the championship game yesterday, dude, Georgia dominated. Back-to-back championships, for those who haven't been paying attention in the college football world, they are on top. No longer is Alabama. And I was telling my young, impressionable brother-in-law, who's all of 24 years old, he's a law student now at a better college. He went to undergrad at Alabama. Now he's at a better college. He's at the University of Wisconsin now doing his law degree. Yeah, that's right. Anyway, he believes, and probably still believes, that Alabama's going to be back and they're going to rule. But I tell you right now, it's obvious that Alabama's been scared for a while. And Nick Saban lashed out at all the other colleges this past summer about NIL money, and it's unfair and blah, 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 blah. He's losing his edge. Georgia's in charge right now, and they showed it last night. Kudos to them. Heck of a game. I mean, that was just incredible. Let's take a look at some slides, shall we? Let's talk about some stuff, what's going on today. These are some of the more interesting things I feel that's going on in the market. None of them are really actionable. I mean, most of us already have a trade on in Microsoft. I'm sure some of you do after that big dip we saw recently and vol went up. Outside of that, I think it's a fairly quiet day. Markets have rallied some from where they were. They're right back to sort of some of the highs of the day. But I think things are pretty quiet heading into, we still got another trading day in front of the CPI number that apparently everybody's seemingly waiting on. Why do I say that? Well, again, we looked at the SPY straddle for that Thursday. We saw it's pricing in a 2.2% move. It still is, of course. That's the event of the week. That's pretty much it. And then some earnings on Friday. But Microsoft is apparently considering a $10 billion investment in ChatGPT. Now, this is interesting on multiple fronts, right? Microsoft obviously has the cash and the ability to do it. I mean, they're looking at different ways of divesting. They do still have that search engine, Bing, which nobody uses. Nobody uses. I would love to know who's using Bing. Nobody is using Bing. And so as a result, they're probably looking at ChatGPT because everybody has been calling it. It's the Google killer. So are they taking a shot at Google? Are they trying to? I mean, it kind of feels like it, right? I mean, and can you blame them? Because Google completely destroyed Bing. I mean, Bing sucked anyway, and Google was just always way that much better, but they've never looked back. I mean, Google is the search engine. You don't say, hey, let's search for something. You say, what? I'm going to Google it. So they definitely cornered that market. It's sort of like the same thing about when people say, like, I don't know if you guys know this, for those of you who might be down south, people usually say, can I have a Coke? They don't say, can I have a soda? They usually say, can I have a Coke? Up here, most in the Midwest, most people say, can I have a pop? But that's not necessarily a name brand. But what do you do when you ask for a tissue? I would love to know. I should have put that in our poll today. As a matter of fact, before I get too carried away, those of you who are watching on the tastylive webpage or tastylive app, you can certainly get into the tastylive YouTube page. And we have a poll, of course. Get in the chat. Type in all kind of characters. I don't care what you type in the chat. Just type in something, right? But there's always good people talking amongst their self. And my man Grumpy Mike, he's like, nobody's typed anything. I thought he'd get the ball rolling. Somebody did beat you, though. Q Antum beat you. He had good afternoon tasty tartars. anyway, there's also a poll. What happens first? VIX sub 20, which is pretty close right now, or VIX over 24? Now, be careful, because you got to remember, we do have a big event coming out in a day or so here. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. Right now, the poll is at 50-50, but get more votes in there and get more likes and subscribes. We got about 58 people watching the show. We only have 4 likes. Let's get that number up. So as I was saying, ChatGPT basically started, it's been sort of exploding up the airwaves since November. Everybody's been talking about it. People have been using it in college to write papers, what have you. I mean, it got the certified stamp of approval from probably the smartest AI person that I know, Dr. Data. He said it's dope. So if he says it's dope, it's got to be dope. And it does some interesting stuff. But you wonder, I think they already have, Microsoft has a $1 billion investment already. Now they're looking at possibly doing 10. Now, again, this hasn't happened yet. They're considering it. But, it already will put it at a valuation of like 20, I don't know. I got to make sure I'm right on this. I think the valuation, I want to say it's somewhere around 30 billion or something like that. It's about $30 billion would this valuation be. So this thing is already fairly valuable. I mean, that puts it, I don't remember a lot of the exactly some of the names that would put it in line with, but the other day GE spun off GE Healthcare, and that was $26 billion, just to give you an idea. So this thing is already fairly valuable and fairly interesting. The company is OpenAI. They've been doing a lot of interesting things, but you really wonder if this is going to be somewhat of a Google killer. I don't know. I guess we'll have to wait and see. Consumer credit increased more than expected in November. This is probably not a surprise. You know all your interest rates are going up. As a matter of fact, from what I understand right now, most people didn't even realize where their current interest rate on most of your credit cards. You've probably got something in the mail that told you it's gone up. Majority of them have gone up. They're not losing the opportunity to charge you more if for some reason you carry a balance. And, you know, obviously interest rates are going higher, so are credit card values. And people are using it more. And you're starting to see people use it more for month-to-month things for every different reason or big expenses. Obviously, that's usually the traditional reason to use credit. But we've seen this tick up for the last several months, and you've seen savings go down. So this is something to keep watching, right? Because this is the kind of big soup where you talk about in the economy where the consumer credit's going up and you're seeing the whole situation happened with cars overall. People are starting to, maybe car prices might be coming down, but car rates are going up, right? It's another thing that you're seeing happen. So there's a big change, obviously, overall in the economy, and you start to wonder how this affects potentially those who might be the unfortunate circumstance of going on unemployment. So something to keep in mind, right? Because then it feeds into the idea of what happens if we do potentially get to a recession, if for some reason GDP goes negative, consumer spending is 2/3 of GDP, you guys can see where all this is going, right? So something to watch. Does this lead to more downside in the market? I know it snowballs. How do you go from consumer credit increased more than expected in November, is at $28 billion, to all of a sudden the market goes down? That's where we are. That's how wide it is. You know what I'm saying? Coinbase eliminates 20% of their staff, but again, you know what's really encouraging? It's never encouraging that people are eliminating their staff, but it's encouraging that this is bad news coming from Coinbase. Obviously, the stock at one point in time took off on the day for this. It's still up on the day. It's cost-cutting measures, right? That's what we're seeing. People say they're eliminating staff, stock goes up. The market has a way of sort of, you end up seeing a lot of the same things in the market at around the same time. This is the current, you know, in vogue thing to do. Companies announce that they're doing layoffs, the stock goes up. But again, I feel like this is, you know, they are trying to save themselves, right, from further ruin. And we've heard more, we've seen more bad news. Other places are eliminating staff in the crypto space. And yet we've still seen Bitcoin rising in a meaningful way to some degree. So I think this is not necessarily completely terrible news. Leftovers. Beer lovers have many choices these days. Let's move ahead to the next slide. This is the share of beer drinkers in the U.S. who drank the following styles of beer in the past year. Lager, 43%. It's usually my preferred. You know, I don't drink beer as much as I used to. But when I do, it's usually either one of the top three, actually. The lager, the pale ale, or the pilsner. Those are usually one of the three that I drink. Wheat beers, man, I used to really love Blue Moon. That was like one of my favorite beers for a long time. It's funny how you go through phases, you know? Like for a long time, Blue Moon was like my choice of beer. That was just what I had. And, you know, you get the little orange slice in it, if you've ever had it. Really good. As a matter of fact, they had a brewery when I lived in Madison, Wisconsin. Blue Moon had a brewery there. That was a nice little spot to hang out. That was my beer for a while. Brown ale. It's kind of generic. Oh, the brown dog. Brown ale. What was it? God, I'm blanking on what it was. No, it wasn't the Brown Dog Brown Ale. I don't remember. There was one brown ale I used to love drinking. I forgot the name of it. Escapes my mind. Stout, of course, first thing that comes to mind is Guinness. Everybody's had Guinness. Guinness has done an incredible job of marketing themselves, haven't they, over the years? Incredible. You know what I don't like? IPAs. If I never drink an IPA again, I'd be fine. I'd be happy. Does not bother me at all. Porters are interesting, but you can't really drink a whole lot of them. You know what I'm saying? Oh, I don't know. George B. says, New England IPA, they're all the rage. What's Henry White Rhine Reds? Are you messing with me? Is that the name of a beer? Or are you just messing with me? Is that really the name of a beer? Okay. Wheat beers, yeah, no longer. So nowadays, it's mostly pilsners. As a matter of fact, either pilsners or lagers. It's usually boring, too. You know what I mean? Like, I'm when it comes to beer now, I'm boring. I mean, I had so many good ones for so many years, and I'm more of a scotch and whiskey drinker now, if anything. You know what I mean? And a Pinot, nice little Pinot works too. Anyway, these are the styles. So 43% of the time, people are picking lagers. Let's move ahead to the next slide. We got bank earnings coming up. One of the bigger ones coming up, of course, is going to be JP Morgan on Friday. As you can see, it's not moving much. Historical volatility is a 15 right now. There's a big difference between historical vol and earnings, or I should say implied vol, which is largely earnings vol. This is typically what you see ahead of earnings, right? You see implied vols trading decent amount over historicals, especially if the stock hasn't moved that much prior to earnings. So right now, this is, you know, the implied vol is 30. IVR, I'm sure, is probably higher. Let's see what IVR is on JP Morgan. Well, that's 27. It's almost right in line. That's not particularly high, I would feel. It's going to be curious to see what a lot of these banks say, right? Like the big thing with the banks is that, you know, one of the things you got to look at for them is their loan loss provisions, right? How much stuff that they have to write down if any of the issue. What's going on with the mortgage side? We saw last earnings, a lot of the banks, JP Morgan, I'm pretty sure was one of them. Most of the job cuts we've seen have been from tech companies. JP Morgan and some of the other banks ended up cutting a decent amount of people from their mortgage side, right? Because they know that there's going to be a slowdown in that area. We've been seeing that. There really haven't been that many people buying new houses over the last several months because the costs have just been too high. It's been exorbitant. And so that's been the area where they've cut down. So if you're looking for things to pay attention to around these earnings coming up for banks, those are definitely two of the areas. And then, of course, JP Morgan has a trading business too, right? So how much people have made off of the trading side. Goldman Sachs has an even bigger part of that. I think they end up going either Monday or Tuesday next week. I'm not exactly sure. So keep an eye out for that for banks. But I don't necessarily know. I consider an IVR of 27 high. So I don't necessarily know what trade I'd be interested in doing, if any, right now. And for those of you who are technical people, those of you who like to trade directionally, well, we'll look at it more. But I'm not exactly particularly excited by a JP Morgan chart neither. Let's move ahead to the next slide. Speaking of, this is the world right now. This is the world. Now, hopefully it's kind of visible. It's not, doesn't look too bad. But I will say, you know, I got the pink dotted line here on 30. 30 is usually where we start to get interested in selling vol, right? These are all the ETFs. So right now, the only things that are above 30 IVR are TLT, GDXJ, which is the miners, which I think for the most part should be higher in volatility, and EWZ, which is, EWZ is Brazil, Brazilian ETF. So obviously, things are going crazy in Brazil. You guys see that? Man, it's almost like, yeah, you guys know what it is. You guys know what it resembles. I'm not going to say it, but you know what it resembles, what's going on there right now. And apparently, the guy who they were doing this for, he's like fled the country. Like he's in Florida somewhere kicking it. I don't know. XLV is a little bit elevated. I've noticed there's been something. I wonder if there's something. I need to look into this and see if there's something going crazy with healthcare vol right now. I've noticed, you know, the one healthcare name that I have is UNH, and it's been down over the last couple of days, and I haven't noticed. I guess when I look at it, and I look at a heat map right now, J&J is down, ABBV is down. There was a big trade that went up in ABBV today. Somebody sold like 10,000 calls and something. What was it? Let me look. Somebody sold 10,000 of the March 175 calls. Stock's currently trading 160. So that's upside calls. So it's almost like as if people are playing for a down move in healthcare, which is interesting to me because if we are theoretically heading for a recession, healthcare is kind of where you want to hang out. I mean, it's not something that that really struggles much. FXE, do you see FXE on the chart? If you do, FXE is the it's the Euro ETF. I would imagine this doesn't show up on here. FXE, IBR is a 40-45. Yeah, for some, oh, you know what? Because my chart only went to 40, so I'm sure it's up there. You're right. FXE, see, that's what's great about the chat. Bull Cub said that FXE vol is 50. Correct. It is. I actually see it as 50. Whether you see it as 45 or 50, as you can see, this chart only goes up to 40. It was just as much as we could fit on the screen. So, but yeah, Eurovol is high right now. And as a matter of fact, if you watch Futures Power Hour, you saw me talking to the illustrious Chris Vecchio. We were talking about Euro a little bit ago, and it's kind of interesting to see the vol up here. Fairly elevated in the Euro right now. It's kind of fascinating. I don't know if it's just because when you look back over the past year, a year ago this time, the vol was fairly low compared to where it is now. That might be part of it. But nevertheless, you can see most of the things are on here are under 30. And my point on this chart is vol is fairly low right now. But you don't need me to tell you that. You can look at the VIX and it can tell you that right now, right? Like VIX is 21. So things are fairly low right now. So be a little bit careful into selling a whole lot of vol. I don't necessarily know if you want to sell a bunch of things right now. There's very few things that I'm really that interested in selling. As a matter of fact, most of the trades that I have on are calendar trades. I might be selling a little bit of Jan and buying a little bit of the next month. So that's kind of where I have been. Let's move ahead to the next slide. No earnings to speak of between tonight and tomorrow. Of course, we got the December CPI on Thursday, and then we got the big bank earnings coming up, beginning to come up on Friday, Wells Fargo, JP Morgan, and Bank of America, most notably. Number of S&P 500 stocks above the 50-day moving average, only 319. I shouldn't say only. I mean, that's greater than 50%. As a matter of fact, it's 63%, but we lost 36 from yesterday. Let's move to the platform. As I look and talk to my, yeah, I was thinking of Newcastle. Yes, AH, Newcastle, the brown dog. It's a brown ale. I used to love drinking that. Chris King, my man. Yes, you guys know what I'm talking about. I used to love drinking Newcastle. Haven't had that in years. Might have to pull that out of the... I might have to go back to that and mess around with it. Bull Cub, for a guy who's only been trading Euro and bonds for the past month, you are on top of it, my friend. You are the guy. See, somebody knew what I was talking about when I talked about... I asked my wife for a Kleenex... I asked for a Kleenex. My wife asked for a tissue. See, I mean, it's kind of like that. It's kind of like that. OpenAI needs to go public. Microsoft can buy it first, but I'm all in. But also praying for a proper market campaign. Yeah, I guess so. Look at Spoo's. Up almost 0.4%. NASDAQ up 0.5%. And Russell 2000 up 1%, fairly strong. But you get the feeling that people are kind of hanging out and not putting on a whole bunch of risk ahead of the event in the next couple of days. If this is doing this today, you wonder what tomorrow is going to be like. Is it going to be that boring? I hope not. Two-year yields up 1.2%. You know, the only thing I like about this is that we're looking at somewhat of a normal market, right, where we see equities up, yields up. As a result of treasuries being down, right? So equities up, treasuries down. That's how the whole 60-40 portfolio works. 60% equities, 40% treasuries. So this is somewhat of a, you know, if there's any positive to take away from it, it's looking more like a traditional market. Because in the past year, yields being up like this usually meant that markets were, equity markets were struggling and probably down. The other thing is volatility, right? It's like right now we're seeing January 21.30 for the January VIX futures down 4% and February VIX futures down 2.7% at 22.40. So, you know, we're seeing contango in the VIX futures curve, as you would imagine, as you would expect. Oil is, you know, well, doing oil things, I guess. But the dollar is down. It's one of the main reasons why it's up. Same thing with gold today. You wonder, I was looking at this earlier, man. The idea of setting up, let's just look at regular GC. I like the way gold has been trading more recently. Is this a GC? No, I just want to see regular GC. Oh, man. Oh, you know what? Something's acting up here. Hold on. not doing what I wanted to do. Well, whatever, no big deal. I hate when it acts up like that. Yeah, I like the way the gold chart has been looking more recently, and it's something I've been paying attention to. You guys can pull it up on your own. But I like the way it's looking. Gold's been trending in an upward direction very slowly up towards 1900. You do wonder if it's going to break out depending on what kind of CPI report we get, because if you look at November 10th, if you look at December, whenever we had the, I think it was December 13th, we had the CPI report then. On those days, and assuming we get similar things on those days that we've seen CPI that we get, coming Thursday, gold could potentially break out. That's one of the things that I'm paying attention to more recently. Whether or not it happens, I don't know. And gold vol is fairly low. This is one where you could start to look at possibly doing something. Never know what they're doing back there. Well, that's fair. $5 for a $10 wide spread. Potentially make $5 on it. 53% chance of making probability of 57%. Probability of profit, 49%. This is about as fair a trade as you can get. My God. But, I'm looking at that. I'm looking at possibly. But I don't know. I don't really want to add many positions. But if I do add a position, gold would probably be the only position that I would potentially be looking at. In the meanwhile, I'm basically just sort of risk managing positions. So yesterday, I don't think I completely explained everything, but I took off my Boeing position. I had a Boeing position. I did like it. I still like Boeing. I'm kind of glad I did. It's down today on some dumb up downgrade, whatever. Reason why I say dumb, it just always seems to happen that way. I don't know. But I had a Feb, as many of you probably know, I had the 220, Jan 220, Feb 220 call time spread. Took all that off, gave me the ability to sort of reallocate some money, and I put on a Lulu call time spread, as many of you know. Ooh, stock is up today. Oh, wow, I didn't realize it was up that much. Where's that at? Oh, right here. Look at that. Hey, that's nice. That works. Stock is up again today. They guided down. You do imagine that most of these clothing companies are going to have to do some markdowns on clothes. But I don't know if the story's quite over yet with Lulu, and so I decided to get long. It's working out so far. It's a nice trade. The only short delta I really have is Meta. I have a short call spread. This is still upside, still no cause for concern. I like it. And Apple is the time spread, put time spread. So that's another, it's not really super short delta, I guess, overall. But some of these, I got what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I was going to sneeze. Almost did. Yeah, I was going to did. See, that's how comfortable I am with you guys. I was about to sneeze. It's whatever. We're all tight. I got 6 names here that have short positions in the January expiration with 10 days to go. So it's up to me to decide if they're close to, if there's anything I want to do with most of them, which most of them are probably out of the money. Like this is out of the money. Disney is right at the money, and so this is what I'm going to have to pay attention to, and I might hold for a while. I'm not going to close it. I'm not going to buy it back. If for some reason it's still here, in the next several days, I'm probably going to hold this one closer to expiration, and maybe I will just close out the whole thing. We'll have to see how it feels. I guess one of the things that's going to happen, the great equalizer, is the CPI number, right? CPI number is going to cause everybody's deltas to shift a good bit, theoretically. I don't know. Maybe I'm hopeful. I just want to see some movement because right now what I don't want to see is VIX sitting here and we do nothing. Because like we said in this poll that we have here, what happens first? Most of you feel, 55% of you feel VIX sub 20 happens before we get to VIX over 24. So I guess we'll see what happens, because if we get some kind of crazy number and things move to the downside real big, I bet we could see a decent sized VIX pop. We're ripe for it. We're certainly ripe for it. I mean, most of the time we've done a lot of studies that show how fast VIX can go higher, right? When VIX is at 20 versus VIX being at 24 and going to, let's just say VIX 20 to 24 is a lot more feasible and faster than VIX 24 to 28, right? you have to, and again, it's all about how much the S&P 500 moves in one of those directions, given how low volatility is at the time. But so I'm monitoring mainly these positions that are 10 days ago, which are all time spreads. And it all depends on how close. Like, this is another one that's really close to strike. I'm not going to go out and buy this back for $2.29. Worst case scenario, I'll let this get to expiration week, and which is next week, and then essentially sort of close the whole position and maybe either reestablish the same thing with doing different expirations or just move on to the next trade, which is more feasible probably than anything. As far as my actual short vol trades, which are, well, you know, another one I got, I'm looking at. So there's two schools of thought here with the Baba trade. I have on the March 105 call long, and I'm short the Feb 120 call short, right? And so there's two schools of thought. I can hold this thing until it gets to around 120, which I actually feel like it could. These Chinese stocks have been really strong more recently, and the opening of China continues to just be a strong story here. Now, that's one thing I could hold on to it, or I close out at 50%. I really wish it would just take it out of my hands and move really big right now in a big direction and force me to have to close it out. But we'll see. You always got to be smart and not, you know, leave money on the table. 45% is a decent sized gain on anything. Should never get too carried away, you know? Should never get too carried away. So, I don't know. I'm talking to myself about different positions. You guys are talking me into it. The other one I still need to pay attention to is this Microsoft. Short put spread to the downside. Hopefully no news comes out and it sort of maintains where it is. I do like the fact that it's it does have earnings coming up sometime in, 2 weeks from today. So something for me to keep an eye on. Anyway, folks, that's all. That's all I got on this today's edition of Engineering Trade. Thanks for watching. And as always, be smart. Be patient, trade small, trade often. See you guys later.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around a bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck.